and human bustles quiet. The bright moon seemed a mirror hung in the air. The scent of duckweed blossoms all at once was sent by the west wind from the far shore. As Tripitaka dismounted, he saw a house at the head of a path. Before the house was erected a pole with a banner flying, while the inside was ablaze with lamps and candles and filled with fragrant incense.
"Wukong?"
said Tripitaka. "What we have here is certainly better than either the fold of the mountain or the edge of the river. At least the eaves of the roof can provide some shelter from the night mists, and we can rest without fears. You, however, should stay behind first, and let me go up to that patron's door to make known our request. If he is willing to let us stay, I'll call for you. But if he's unwilling, all of you are not to let loose any mischief. You are, after all, quite ugly in your appearances, and I fear that you may frighten them. Offending these people may mean that we shall have nowhere at all to stay."
"What you say is quite right," said Pilgrim.
"Please go first, master, and we'll wait for you here." Taking off his broad-brimmed bamboo hat, the elder shook the dirt from his clerical robe and went up to the door of the house, holding the priestly staff in his hands. He found the door half closed. Not daring to enter without permission, the elder stood still and waited for a brief moment, when an old man, with some beads hanging around his neck, emerged from the house, chanting the name of Buddha as he walked. Seeing that the old man was about to shut the door, however, the elder hurriedly pressed his palms together and cried out, "Old benefactor, this humble priest salutes you." Returning his greeting, the old man said,
"You are too late, monk."
"What do you mean?" said Tripitaka.
"I mean that you won't get anything because you are late," said the old man.
"If you had come earlier, you would have found that we were feasting the monks. After you have eaten your fill, you would then be given an additional 3 ounces of cooked rice, a bale of white cloth, and 10 strings of copper pennies.
Why do you come at this hour,
old benefactor?" said Tripitaka, bowing. "This humble priest is not here to be feasted."
"If you are not," said the old man,
"then why have you come here?" Tripitaka said. "I am someone sent by imperial decree of the great Tang in the land of the east to acquire scriptures in the western heaven. It was late when we arrived at your region. When we heard the sound of drums and cymbals from your house, we came to ask you for one night's lodging.
We'll leave by morning,
monk," said the old man, waving his hand gently. "A man who has left the family should not lie. The distance between our place here and your great Tang in the land of the east happens to be 54,000 miles. A single person like you, how could you come here all by yourself?"
"That's an exceptionally accurate observation, old benefactor," said Tripitaka.
"But I am not alone. I have 3 disciples who have opened up a path through the mountains and built bridges when we came upon the waters. It was because of their being my escorts that I could arrive here today."
"If you have disciples," said the old man,
"why haven't they come with you? Please invite them forth at once. My house has enough room for all of you." Turning around, Tripitaka said,
"Disciples, come here."
Now, Pilgrim was by nature rather impulsive, Eight Rules was born without manners, and Sha Monk, too, happened to be very impetuous. The moment the 3 of them heard their master beckoning, they rushed like a cyclone toward the house, dragging the horse and the luggage along. When the old man caught sight of them, he was so terrified that he fell on the ground, crying repeatedly,
"Monsters are here! Monsters are here!"
Raising him with his hands, Tripitaka said,
"Don't be afraid, benefactor. They are not monsters. They are my disciples."
Trembling all over, the old man said,
"Such a handsome master. Why did you take such ugly disciples?
Though they are not good to look at," said Tripitaka. "They are quite knowledgeable in taming tigers and subduing dragons, in seizing monsters and capturing fiends." Not fully believing what he heard, the old man supported himself on the Tang monk and walked slowly with him inside. "We tell you now about those 3 rogues who dashed into the hall,
where they dropped their luggage and tied up the horse. There were at that time several priests in the hall reciting sutras. Sticking out his long snout, Eight Rules shouted at them. "Hey monks! Which sutra are you reciting?" On hearing this, those monks raised their heads and all at once, they saw a visitor. With long snout and huge ears. A thick frame and wide shoulders. A voice that boomed like thunder. But pilgrim and Sha monk were in looks even uglier. Of those priests in the hall, none was not in terror. They tried to keep reciting, but were stopped by their leader. They left their stones and bells, and forsook the graven Buddhas. The lamps were all blown out, and torches all smothered. They scrambled and they stumbled, the door sills falling over, like gourds when props were down. Their heads bumped one another. A pure, serene plot of ritual became a cause of great laughter. When the three brothers saw how those priests stumbled and fell all over, they clapped their hands and roared with laughter. More terrified than ever, those priests banged into one another as they fled for their lives and deserted the place. Tripitaka led the old man up the hall, but the lights and lamps were completely out, while the three of them were still in guffaws. "You brazen creatures!" scolded the Tang monk. "You are so wicked. Haven't I taught you every day, admonished you every morning?" The ancients said. "To be virtuous without instruction. Is this not sagacity? To be virtuous after instruction. Is this not nobility? To be virtuous even after instruction. Is this not stupidity? The way you have perpetrated mischief has just shown you to be people of the greatest baseness and stupidity. You barged into someone's door without any manners. You have frightened the old benefactor and scattered the priests reciting the sutras, completely spoiling the good works of others. Wouldn't I be blamed for all this?" He spoke with such vehemence that they dared not utter a word in reply, and only then did the old man become convinced that they were his disciples. He turned quickly to bow to Tripitaka, saying, "Venerable Father, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. They were putting out the lights just now because the ceremony was almost done anyway. If it's over," said Eight Rules, "bring out the end of service feast so that we can enjoy it and sleep. Bring out the lights. Bring out the lights," cried the old man. Some of the members of his household, when they heard him, began to complain to themselves. "There are enough candles already in the hall for the religious service. Why is he calling for lights?" A few houseboys came out to see for themselves and they found the hall in complete darkness. Returning hurriedly with torches and lanterns, they suddenly saw the forms of Eight Rules and Sha monk. So terrified by the sight they were that they dropped their torches and dashed inside, slamming shut the mid-level door and shouting all the time, "There are monsters here! There are monsters here!" Picking up one of the torches, Pilgrim relit the lamps and the candles before he pulled a chair to the middle of the hall for the Tang monk to sit on. Then he and his brothers sat down on both sides and the old man took a seat in front of all of them. As they sat led into their seats, they heard the inner door open and another old man walked out, supporting himself on a staff. "What kind of perverse demons are you?" he said. "That you dare enter the door of a virtuous family in the dark of night." The old man, who was seated, quickly arose and met him behind the screens, saying, "No need to clamor, elder brother. They are no perverse demons, but arhats sent to acquire scriptures by the great Tang in the land of the East. Though they look vicious, they are actually quite gentle." Only then did the other old man put down his staff and bow to greet all four of the visitors, after which he also took a seat in the front of the hall. "Bring out the tea," he cried, "and prepare us some vegetarian food." He had to call several times before several houseboys, still trembling, emerged, though they still did not dare walk near the visitors. Unable to contain himself, Eight Rules said, "Old man, why are your servants milling about on both sides? I told them to bring out some vegetarian food to serve to the venerable fathers. said the old man. Eight rules asked. How many are there to serve us?
Eight of them,
said the old man. Which of us are they going to serve?
Said eight rules.
Why, all four of you,
said the old man. Eight rules said. That pale-faced master requires only one person to serve him. The one with the hairy face and thunder god beak needs only two. But the one with the gloomy complexion will have to have eight persons, and, as for me, nothing less than 20 attendants will do.
If I understand you correctly, said the old man.
You are trying to tell me that you have a large appetite.
It's passable, passable, said eight rules.
Well, said the old man. There are plenty of people here. Young and old, he managed to summon 30 servants to come out. As the two old men spoke amiably with the monks, the rest of the household felt more at ease. A table was set up in the middle of the hall, and the Tang monk was asked to take the honored seat. Three other tables were set up on both sides for the disciples, while the two old men were seated at another table facing all of them. Fruits and vegetables were presented first, after which they brought out glutinous rice, plain rice, side dishes, and soup with vermicelli. After the food was laid out properly, the elder Tang lifted his chopsticks and recited the fast-breaking sutra.